Can you imagine not knowing where your child is for 3 days? That's the anguish going on inside this house.
Right now, we just need her home. Like, I don't know if she's stuck somewhere. Mm-hmm. I don't know if she's trapped. I don't know if she's eating.
If someone shows you who they really are the first time, believe it. And be aware of love hidden with hate. This is the tragic case of Jholie Moussa. Hi, I'm Leah Fields. If you're new, welcome. So, about this case. Now, this case really pissed me off, like, because I didn't realize how many teenagers deal with domestic violence, but it's real. So if this is a trigger to anyone, please click off of this video and go ahead and watch another video of mine. But I just want to let you guys know, because I don't want to, you know, offend anyone or bring up any type of feelings that you don't need, we all don't need. But I do want to bring awareness for Black and Brown victims. Please share and subscribe. Leave a thumbs up and comment below so you never miss a video. And I'm also on my road to 1,000 subscribers. Currently, I think I'm at like 800. So if you don't subscribe, I'm gonna just think you're fake, because a lot of y'all be sitting watching the whole video but not subscribing to join the family over here. So on that note, go ahead and press that little subscribe button so we can go ahead and jump into today's case. Jholie Moussa was born on March 21st, 2001 to her parents, Syreeta Stewart and Cyrell Moussa. Jholie Moussa was a 16-year-old from Alexandria, Virginia, a very nice suburban town, a great area to raise a family. Jholie also had a twin sister, Jhanae Moussa, which she was very, very close to. I mean, they had a very strong bond that no one could break ever since birth. So if you saw Jholie, you saw Jhanae too. Jholie was also known to be very ambitious, great in school, you know, a happy spirit, and Jholie actually loved to write poems as well, and music and stories. Her dream was to attend NYU to become a writer. She wanted to publish books, like that was her passion, that's all she wanted to do. So I really admired that about her, because I don't know a lot of people that really want to be authors. So that was definitely very admirable. So the twins, they both lived with their father in Virginia, and their mother actually lived in Texas. So the girls actually went to high school in Alexandria, Virginia. They attended Mount Vernon High School, and during Jholie's freshman year, she actually met a boy, a classmate named Nabu Abraham. Nabu would always admire Jholie from afar, always staring at her, and he pretty much had a crush on her, and Jholie noticed that. And, you know, she didn't think that it was weird that he was always staring at her, because she thought he was cute as well. He was a part of the basketball team. He was very popular. And not only was he an athlete, he was actually a great student as well. Very smart. He wasn't known either to be in any trouble, like just a good kid all around. So one day Nabu made his move, like he finally went to talk to Jholie, and ever since that moment they were like inseparable. And it also helped a lot that he was also well-mannered and respectful towards Jholie and others. So her parents thought that, you know, Nabu is a good kid, like of course, you know, y'all can date, you know, I don't think there's anything wrong with him, y'all in love, y'all have this puppy love going on, okay, cool. So Nabu became Jholie's first real boyfriend. You know, she was happy, he was happy. We've all had that high school relationship that we were just head over heels, like it meant everything to us, and that was their relationship. So on January 12, 2018, Jholie and her sister came home from school. You know, it's a regular day around 4 p.m. and their father was actually out of town. So it was just Jholie and Jhanae at home. And that night, they were actually supposed to spend the night at one of their friends, basically like a girl sleepover. So Jholie was supposed to spend the night at her friend's house, and Janae was going to spend the night at another friend's house. So they both had their own individual friends, their own individual lives, even though they were so like close with one another, they both still had like their own things going on. So on that night before they go out to their sleepover, you know, they're getting ready, they're doing their hair, they're having girl talk, you know, probably talking about boys, gossiping, pretty much what we all talked about when we were like 16 years old. But Jholie seemed a bit preoccupied with her phone. Like every 4 seconds she was checking her phone constantly, and Janae, she's like, yo sis, like who got your attention like that, because you're literally on your phone every second. So Jholie gets a Snapchat notification and she's like, hold on, I gotta step out real quick, I'll be right back. So Janae is like, what you mean you'll be right back, like where are you going? She's like, I'll be right back. And she runs out into a car, but sadly that would be the last time her sister and her family sees Jholie again. So now Janae is waiting at the house for Jholie to arrive. You know, she didn't think that it was going to be long because Jholie told her, hey, I'll be right back, it's going to be real quick, I'm just about. But Jholie never came home. So her sister is like, whoa, you know, where are you? But she's also not panicking because she almost feels like, all right, maybe she went to her friend's house to the sleepover. Maybe she just went straight there. But later on that night, Janae received a text from Jholie stating, hey, I'm going down to Norfolk, Virginia to Old Dominion University for a party. Meanwhile, Norfolk is like 3 to 4 hours away. So Janae is like, wait, what? Like, that's out of town. Like, what are you doing, pretty much? So Janae texts back Jholie like, yo, like what's going on, like I'm confused. But Jholie wouldn't just pick herself up and leave out of town like that, so that definitely created a worry for Janae a bit, because it was just really like left field, but she still didn't really ponder on it so much. So Jholie's friends reaches out to Janae like, hey, I can't get in touch with Jholie, was she still coming over? So now Janae is freaking out because she was supposed to be at the sleepover, but that never happened, and no one is able to reach Jholie at this point. Ever since Jholie sent that text message to Janae stating, hey, I'm going to a party at Old Dominion University, no one can reach her. So now everyone's in panic mode. So Janae is constantly calling Jholie, like constantly, multiple times, and Jholie is not picking up the phone. So she knows that something is wrong. So she reached out to their uncle for help, which would keep eye on them when their father would go out of town for work. And also their mom is all the way in Texas as well. So the nearest adult is their uncle. So he finds out what's going on and he rushes over to the house immediately. And at this point, no one knows where she is. Now the family house had a camera in front of the house, and you can actually see Jholie walking into a car, but you can't see who's driving the car, who's in the passenger seat, or who's in the car, period. So they check that, but that's not really giving them any information on, you know, who she left with. Now we're moving into the next day, January 13th, and Jholie is still not home. So Jholie's parents file a missing report because Janae and the uncle let the parents know, like, yo, we can't reach Jholie. We called her multiple times. She's not at her friend's house. She said that she left somewhere to a party 3 hours away. We still can't get in contact with her. But the police wasn't really receptive to the news because they didn't think Jholie was in danger. So we move on to the next day, January 13th. Now, a whole day goes by and Jholie is not home. So Janae and, you know, her uncle, they let the parents know, yo, we cannot find Jholie. She's not at her friend's house. She's, you know, not home yet. She's not picking up her calls. We're worried. And that's not like Jholie to not call anyone, to not reach out back to anyone. you know, just get up and go to a party 3 hours away. Like, that is definitely out of her character. She was very responsible. And, you know, she was known to be actually the more serious sister, the more, like, you know, adamant about certain things. And not to say that Janae wasn't, but Janae was definitely more, like, free-spirited, and Jholie was just a lot more, like, you know, like, serious about certain things. So that being her character, she definitely would have let someone know, reach right back out, hey, I'm going to this party, I'll be back home at this certain time, or just basically keep everyone in the loop. But she never did that. So at this point, everyone's worried, and they reach out to police to file the missing report, but the police wasn't really receptive to the news because they didn't think Jholie was even in danger. Meanwhile, Jholie was only 16. So that just caused a lot of frustration because people felt like the authorities wasn't really applying pressure to find Jholie, almost like brushing it aside. If you're 16 years old, pressure should be applied. You're a minor. So she's a minor missing, not with her parents or friends, but authorities stated because Jholie left the house at her own will, they didn't believe that she was in trouble or abducted. So they lacked to push out any news or Amber Alerts about Jholie missing. So 10 days pass, 10 days, and Jholie's parents and family are worried and just heartbroken. But no one will ever be prepared to find news that your child or loved one is gone. On January 15th, authorities announced that there was a body in Woodland Park, a mile from where Jholie actually lived. The body was covered in leaves and put away to be hidden. The body was announced to be Jholie, and now this was classified as a homicide case. Authorities actually received the news that Jholie was at Woodland Park from a 13-year-old boy, which I'm not going to put his name out there, but if you do your own research, you'll find it yourself. And it was January 12, 2018 at the time when the 13-year-old boy was playing basketball when a man actually walked up to him and asked him to use his cell phone to make a call. So he gives his phone to the man. He's like, okay, cool. And the man was actually described as an African-American man and 6 feet tall. So authorities get in contact with this boy and they're like, all right, you know, we need to see this phone. They saw a phone call to Jholie around the same time she left the house. Now, I know everyone is waiting to find out who was the man. The man that the 13-year-old boy saw at the park and that used his phone to make a phone call was actually Jholie's boyfriend, Nibiu Ibrahim. So by the time they figure out that Nibiu was a person of interest, months go by, and on August 31st, 2018, Nibiu was arrested and taken in for questioning. Jholie and Nibiu started as the perfect couple, like I said, but over time, their relationship began to turn very, very dark. Their relationship was extremely toxic. Nibiu had been physically abusing Jholie, and Jholie notified her sister and parents about it. There was an incident, they had an argument, and Nibiu actually strangled Jholie until she lost consciousness and slapped her around a few times. And that caused Nibiu to actually have an assault and strangulation charge against him because she went back to tell her parents about what happened. They were like, oh no, this is not gonna fly. So they took Nibiu to court to get that handled. So when Nibiu first had that charge against him, he actually wasn't able to contact Jholie after that, which, you know, there was a no contact order. And he also wasn't able to play on his school basketball team either after that situation because the school didn't want anything to do with him. So they sent him off to an alternative high school. At that high school, there was no basketball, and that's all Nibiu loved. That was his dream. He wanted to be in the NBA. He wanted to play basketball all day. Like, basketball was life for him. So that caused him to even act more crazy than he already was. he's harassing Jholie every single day. He's trying to get in contact with her. He's, you know, pretty much stalking her and bothering her. So now that's when we lead up to them having a conversation on Snapchat. And the person that she went to go see was actually Nibiu. So because Nibiu showed violence to Jholie prior while they were dating and already charged for assault, police was like, okay, let's definitely look into her ex-boyfriend to see if he's responsible of Jolie's murder. During the interrogation, Nibiu admits that him and Jholie was talking throughout the day on Snapchat the day she disappeared. They weren't even supposed to be talking, like I said, because there was a no contact order set in place. But Nibiu was like, he was on it. Like, he wanted to talk to Jholie. He needed to get in contact with her. It was almost like he was obsessed with her, and he was at this point stalking her, if you want to put it that way. So he's like, meet me at the park. And that's when he asked the 13-year-old boy to use his phone to talk to Jholie to come to the park. So that's when Jholie arrives at the park to talk to Nibiu. And they're walking in the park, and while they're walking, Jholie starts to walk a little bit ahead of Nibiu, and Nibiu sets himself up into a MMA chokehold stance and started to strangle Jholie from behind. He stated he doesn't know what led him to that point, but he didn't stop there. He gets on top of Jholie while she's already passed out from the MMA chokehold stance, meaning like he's behind her choking her. And I'll put an image just so you can see the stance of how he was. And she already passes out from that. The evil within him, he gets on top of her while she's already passed out and started to strangle her some more. So he takes Jholie's body and tries to hide her by putting leaves over her body, and he grabs her phone and sent a message to her sister. That was actually him texting on her phone. And he confessed after a couple of days that he tried to go back to the park and dig a ditch with a knife to put Jholie's body in it, but he failed. So the evil and anger within this boy, like, what blew me was the fact that Jholie was already passed out from his chokehold. And let's just say she probably wasn't even dead. She probably just passed out. But the fact that he wanted to make sure that she wouldn't wake up, he went on top of her to make sure. Like, that just kind of just blew me. That pissed me off. That got me, like, so upset. That I can't understand how someone can be like that evil. I'm sorry, like, that part just really. So he told police his motive for killing Jholie was that he was transferring schools that didn't have a basketball program. He was pretty much upset that he wasn't able to play basketball. So after police spent hours getting information about Nibiu's confession, he is charged on June 12, 2019. Ibrahim pleaded guilty to first-degree murder in the slaying of Jholie Moussa. He was sentenced to 99 years in prison for the murder charges. But I'm going to say this now for all the women and men that's watching, young or old. Don't ever in your life apologize for being abused, whether that's emotionally and physically. Don't ever let a person who did you wrong make you feel insecure or guilty. Don't do it, because he was actually in the wrong. But every single day, he would call Jholie to let her know how angry he was and pissed off at her, even though he put his hands on her. Jholie actually took that little step in telling her parents, hey, this man harmed me. She still kept in contact with him. She still felt so guilty and bad about it, even though he harmed her, and that led to her death. And I think maybe Jholie still had love for Nibiu, and that's why she left the house that day, not notifying anyone about where she was going. Because I deeply believe that if she told her sister was not going to approve her leaving the house to go see him, because he already harmed her. Everyone knew about what he did to her. So I know Jholie just kept that to herself to go. Maybe she felt like, you know, he's gonna change, or maybe she felt like, you know, things will be different this time. But she's not here anymore. And even grown women still have issues with leaving an abuser. So that's why I'm encouraging you guys to really, like, find help, seek help. It's not normal. It's not okay that he or she is putting their hands on you, harming you, making you feel like crap. It's not normal. But the family did say throughout the relationship that they would have never known that it would have been taken this far where an abuse would actually kill Jholie. They never thought that. And that was something that I was really paying attention to, because you never know. You really don't know. You would never think what people's true intentions are. But like I said early on in the beginning, if someone shows you who they are the first time, believe it. Don't ignore it. He already showed himself when he was abusing her. But Jholie still was just, you know, she still wanted, I guess, his love. I guess that relationship, you know, she was 16 at the time. That's her first real boyfriend. So I could understand how hard it is to leave someone when they're your first everything. But I just want to encourage young teenagers, literally teenagers, because there's a lot of teenage cases that I've done research on, and it definitely centers around domestic abuse. And I really just want to encourage some of you guys that y'all don't have to stay in those relationships at all. Protect yourself, your mind, your heart, and your body, because it can save you your life. There is a very high statistic that Black women are more prone to be killed by domestic violence. And I'm not here to bash other ethnic groups, but I'm also going to share facts because I'm a Black woman, so I can relate to that, and I notice it. I notice that there's a high rate, with Black women being killed, Black men as well, due to domestic violence. So I really encourage our Black women and Black men to really reach out if you're in a violent relationship at all costs to protect yourself. Jholie's mother definitely feels like her daughter's death was just pointless, and it really was. Her family is still healing and actually bringing awareness about domestic violence till this day. Jholie's mother and her sister now live in Texas. And they even helped a friend that was in a domestic abusive relationship with her mom. They felt good that they were able to save a girl because they knew what it could have possibly led to, because they experienced that firsthand, and they didn't want that to happen to someone else. So I definitely applaud them for that. I definitely applaud them for still, you know, keeping their spirit up to help other people. But, you know, this is the tragic case of Jholie Moussa. I hope you guys really take care of yourselves. I hope you guys protect yourself. And if some of y'all don't know, I always end my video with a prayer for the victims. So I'm going to go ahead and jump into the prayer for Jholie Moussa's family. Father God, I just thank you for this platform that you have for me. I thank you for creating this platform so that I can share victim stories that can help other people that are going through hard times, such as domestic abuse. I pray for Jholie's parents. I pray for her family, Lord God. I pray for peace and healing, Lord God. I pray for her sister, Father, Lord God. I pray for Janae right now, Lord. I know there's probably some days that it's hard without being with her sister, Jholie. I know there's days where, you know, she's hurting. She's hurting bad. And I just pray, Father, Lord God, that you pour your peace over Janae. You pour your peace and love over her. I pray for Jholie's mother, Lord God, and her father. I pray that you know, their spirits are still intact. I know it's hard losing a child. I've never experienced that, but Lord, I have a baby girl, so I know that could be something so drastic and so heartbreaking. So Lord, I cover them with your love and your peace, and protect every last viewer that is actually going through domestic violence. Let them know, Lord, speak through them. Let them know that this is not the end, that they can get out of this with your love and with your help. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. I want to say thank you so much for watching. Thank you for supporting. And I'll see you guys in the next video.